would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this workshop or conference, whatever you may call it. The point is, as I was telling you, that we have been in news for quite some time, and suddenly there was a sudden darkness. And it's I would say that AVP has been always acknowledging our contribution, and thanks for that. When I'm talking of bioethics and Ayurveda, bioethics is a relatively modern term coming up in 1960s. And comparing it to Ayurveda, when we talk of bioethics, always the lectures, you know, start with the Western principles which are enunciated as the so-called bioethics. But then we also know that in our country, when we talk of bioethics, we can't forget about traditional, the inheritance of our traditional values. And when it comes to medicine, it's Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani. All of these traditional systems of medicine have actually enunciated principles how to bear yourself as a physician. So before I go on to what is bioethics and all that, I would like to start it from the beginning. The native cultures that we had. The native cultures actually believed in natural forces. We talk about Panchabhutas. It was very much similar to what the Greek philosophers thought of, except that in Ayurveda we have another element added to it, ethereal. So you have the earth, fire, and the sky, and so on, the Panchabhutas. And also the belief in the cosmos. So Aham Brahmasmi, that we are one with the cosmic environment. So the concept of cosmophysiology was very much there, that we imbibe in us the elements, and then when we die, we go back to those elements. So that was the philosophy generated, and this was also believed very much in the Hellenistic cultures. And also there was an element of belief in mysticism, so spirits. So all these were actually, you know, coming together to make the people, make principles as to how you should conduct yourself. And as a result, whether it is Hinduism or Rabbinic Judaism, early Christianity and so on, talk of any religion for that matter, the caring for concept was there. And earlier days you used to have travelers in and hospices, and now we have hospitals, and then again hospitals, corporate hospitals have again converted to the concept of hospices. Because if you go to say Apollo Hospital and all those things, you will find that you are as if in your house, but of course you have to pay quite a bit for that sort of care. So a number of texts in Ayurveda have been actually quoted by different authors, but as you know, Charaka Samhita, Sushruta Samhita, and Bhagavata's treatise are very commonly quoted and very well known for what they talk about a physician. And others are Kaya Samhita, and then later versions Madhava Sarvadhara and Bhavad Mishra. But there are many others also, and I was actually happy to get a copy of the book written by an author who had actually, I will come to that slide a bit later, who had extensively studied a lot of literature on these aspects. But what we can, what she has actually, Dagmar Bojastik, I don't know how to pronounce it anyway. So she has written Well-Mannered Medicine and extensively quoted Western authors as well as the Indian authors. And one point that was, somebody was saying about, you know, what was the evidence created and all that. There used to be oral transmission of information those days, and there was no written form. And people, as was told earlier, used to gather together to discuss whether these treatments are okay and all that. And we have actually information that some of these were held in Himalayas. So probably those were the earliest, you know, association of physicians of India, probably. So that way they used to exchange, and it's much, much later that it actually got documented. And the, this author actually isolated so many principles pertaining to various aspects, general ethics, professional and academic ethics, pre-operative ethics, operative ethics, post-operative ethics, ethics and importance of experimental surgery, the information about quacks, how they should be treated by the society, ethics related to dying and ethics in emergency surgery. So those days, throughout the centuries it traveled, this ethics in Ayurveda was not at all influenced by the social, local, moral assumptions, the changes in political orders, kings, so many kings had changed, then religious allegiances. But in modern times it has become very much a reality, and these factors do influence decisions. So whether you take Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, all of them speak the same language. Medical ethics is very much an integral part of practice. And as was told, the belief, general belief is that it is practice related, but no. There was a lot of observation over the years, over the centuries, which was passed down. That was nothing but research. And it was for the betterment of the patient. So, few points from Charak Samhita, that is, the primary concern should be the safety in the best interest of the patient. There has to be a liberal outlook. It has to be cost-effective treatment for the poor. No drastic or costly measure for the incurable. Maintain confidentiality, avoid institutional entanglements. Those days itself, it was very much clear that one should not go against the order of the country, I mean, order of the king. And refrain from unsavory financial deals, which very much nowadays Medical Council of India has brought in one point on that. Practice of gifting physicians by the industry, pharmaceutical industry. Then refrain from advertising. That also has become one of the principles which has been added to the Medical Council of India Act now. And then professionalism with patients and colleagues. So if we actually trace the philosophy, Indian philosophy, before 2000 AD, actually the documented Ayurvedic texts have different ages. You know, there is a controversy about it. Some say 10th century BC, some say that it is 1st and 2nd century AD. But we will not go into that. Before 2000 AD, it was supposed to be pre-systematic. And these were the Vedas and the Upanishads, the Pali Buddhist texts and Jain Agamas. The Vedas were actually expected to be based on the practices, the health practices of the Indus Valley civilization. So it goes very much earlier to that. And the systematic is where we see the emergence of different philosophical schools, logical systems, metaphysical theories, and schools of philosophy called darshanas. So it got divided into two forms, the orthodox school and the heterodox school. The orthodox school were actually systems which believed in the Vedas, accepted the authority of Vedas, the Sankhya, Yoga, Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Purva Mimamsa and Uttara Mimamsa. And there was verbal testimony as a means to knowledge. Whereas the Nastika, the heterodox schools for Buddhism, Jainism and Charvaka, which is actually materialistic thoughts, and they rejected the Vedic authority. But whatever the scene, they actually talked about Prameya, the nature of reality, Pramana, nature and criteria of knowledge, and Purushartha, values for goals of life. And these Purusharthas were again divided into Dharma, that is duties and moral responsibilities, Artha, wealth, Kama, the desire, and Moksha, the highest one among them, which very few actually attain. Coming to Dharma again, there was the Sadhana Dharma and Vishesha Dharma. Sadhana Dharma pertained to universal principles and could be applied for all occasions by all. And it was simple, like honesty, compassion, respecting others, kindness, humility. And the moral obligations were you needed to be very truthful, non-maleficent, compassionate, and you should not steal. Whereas Vishesha Dharma was actually based on the cultural environment that existed at that time. So the obligations pertaining to that, the institutional affiliations, the family background, the social status and the gender and the stage in life. So there were professional obligations actually outlined there. And this actually was based on the class systems. And we have, of course, the mention of euthanasia in Ayurveda. You all are very familiar with Mahabharata, the state of Bhishma lying on arrows. So he says to the physicians, those physicians who were brought to treat him, he says, give generous and benefiting presents of money to these good surgeons and pay them due honor and send them away to me in this condition. No treatment is welcome. I must be allowed to die. And today euthanasia is a big topic of discussion in the Western as well as the other parts of the world. Rhinoplasty is another factor that I would like to mention. The nose mutilation, which was a form of punishment, public punishment for immoral conduct for any reason. So these people actually, nose was considered as a right to privacy in the physical form. So if you cut the nose, it was the highest dishonor that you could do to a person. So rhinoplastic surgery actually developed at that time, and Shushruta was mainly responsible for this. Not only improved the aesthetic measure, but also restored the physical privacy of the individual. So this was another ethical principle that was applied in those days. Now when we come to the modern times, when we talk of ethics, whether bioethics actually is clinical ethics or medical ethics plus research ethics. So whether you talk of any of these, especially if you talk of research ethics, we have two pillars protecting the human participants, and that is independent review, that is ethics committee's role, and informed consent process. But when you talk of Ayurveda practice, the welfare of the, it's not human participants but patients. The doctor, the medicine, the patient and the attendant were supposed to be the four pillars. And different texts give different variants of the principles underlying this. The main fact is that doctor is the overall person in charge. How he dispenses the medicine, how he takes care of the patient, and also includes the attendant in the whole process. And it also depends on how the attendant is. In our times, in the modern medicine, attendant would be probably a person who would actually sign the informed consent form as a witness. So, but the role anyway of the attendant is very important, whether it is those olden days or the modern times. So whether you take the 10th century BC document, or you take the 4th century BC Hippocratic Oath, all they meant was primum non nocere, that is first do no harm. So first do no harm, that is called the non-maleficence principle, which is the universal principle across all types of religion or practice, medical practice or research ethics. So when we come back to bioethics, what does it mean actually? It's only in 1972 that it was defined as a systemic study of the moral dimensions, including moral mission, decisions, conduct and policies of the life sciences and healthcare, employing a variety of ethical methodologies in an interdisciplinary setting. So the main thing is, it talked about moral dimensions, it talked about the variety of ethical methodologies that could be used for that, and an interdisciplinary setting. That's very important. That's why your ethics committee also has an interdisciplinary nature. You have non-scientists as well as scientists in that committee. So if you trace the history of Western bioethics, it was much, much later that the first code of medical ethics was actually outlined by Thomas Percival. And on his writing was based the American Medical Association's adoption of the Percival Code as the ethical, as the code for the physicians in 1947. And 1947 is the time when we had the, what was the period, anybody can tell that 1947 was very important year. Ethics, related to ethics. Independence, we have Indian independence. What else? very important document called the Nuremberg Code came as a result of the Nazi experiments. A trial was held and it was held in Nuremberg, so it was called Nuremberg Code. So the Nuremberg Code actually got some of the principles adopted from this Percival Code. And then you know the history. 1960s, the bioethics word got coined, and it's only in 1970 that you had the Encyclopedia of Bioethics. The first edition came out at that time. So the normal ethical theories are based on how you consider the circumstances leading to consequences. For example, if you do something now and you think that it can be a very good thing for the future generation or something like that, that is called greatest good for the greatest number. But suppose you want to do something today, you are not bothered about the consequences. But whatever you do should be in the right spirit, should be the right action. Then you call yourself as Kantian, that is deontology. So the greatest good for the greatest number is teleontology, and the other one is deontology. A good example is dropping of the atomic bomb. So what did it do actually? Anybody? When the atom bomb was dropped, what happened? War got over. So was it the greatest good for the greatest number? Yes. It stopped the war. So naturally, many people got saved, isn't it, from fighting in the field and getting and dying. But what was wrong with that?
Mutations.
The local suffering, isn't it? So if you were to think in the larger aspect, Americans thought of, you know, stopping the war, teaching a lesson to the enemies. So for them it was greatest good for the greatest number. But for the Japanese who suffered, if you look back, the person who actually dropped the bomb as a national pride, you know, action of, he felt very proud to be the executor of that. What happened to him later? He committed suicide because he did not even realize what harm had been done to the people. He just couldn't bear to think that he was the perpetrator for that. So his action was not right. Okay, the consequence, it's not dependent on the consequence. So that's how you have the consequentialist and the non-consequentialist. So summarizing, rules of behavior as described in Ayurveda are mentioned more as an etiquette. It is never written separately as ethics, but it is always there in the text. The undercurrent is always there. So the principles of right and wrong are accepted by an individual or social group or synonym for morality was always mentioned in many of the passages. So do you think Ayurvedic principles are Kantian or are they the greatest good for the greatest number? Kantian means the act should be right. Where does it belong to? Which group does it belong to? Any guesses? Do you think it is the greatest good for the greatest number? So you feel it's Kantian. Yes, it is supposed to be more in Kantian philosophical type. And in fact, Arthur Schopenhauer actually improved the Kantian philosophy based on the Indian philosophy. Physicians should be spiritual, knowledgeable, truthful and confident, and also have moral obligation to attain new knowledge and skills for evolving better treatment. So the onus was actually placed on the physician. And another point that I wanted to highlight was that if any, if a person is known to be on the stages nearing death, a drastic experiment had to be done. For that, actually the permission of the family as well as the ruler was taken. Because if something goes wrong, he would be put behind bars. So the precaution was taken to take the permission of the family as well as the ruler. But the patient was not important. patient's consent was not important. So remember that. That's the instance where you can get evidence that informed consent of the patient was not required in such circumstances. Sometimes, and this also may be based on previous experience that they would have done where it would have been successful, but it's not guaranteed that in this particular patient it may work. So that's why that precaution was taken. So irrespective of risk-benefit assessment, experimental treatment could be attempted with permission from the state. These were the main principles highlighted in Ayurveda. And I have just tried to actually compare it to what we talk of bioethics in modern times. Thank you.
If it is so effective, then
why it is not accepted and applied all over the India in all branches?
What is effective?
Bioethics of Ayurveda is told. It seems to be very good, as like madam has been told. But why it is not acceptable in other systems, or even it is not applied to the other systems, even modern, whatever?
See, modern medicine doesn't have, I mean, the Indian ICMA guidelines are pertaining to that only. But still we see violations, isn't it? See, people who existed in bygone days were much more honest. And now because of the sheer number of population, it's a free-for-all survival. So in that process, you have seen the IPL things and all, the people want to get richer and things like that. All these, you know, vices, the virtue ethics that was being talked about is no longer considered like that. It's only few people who actually pertain to that and stick to that. And that's why we need to have the regulations by the government. That is the state. You know, when you talk of ethics, ethics starts with moral integrity, the internal fiber of your moral integrity. You know, you're born with that actually. But your environment changes it. And as you change your environment, the cultural norms existing in that environment lay down some guidelines. For example, a man holding the hand of a woman. Okay. Now this will be okay in some cultures, but it will not be okay in some other cultures. So these are the guidelines to how to behave. Okay. Now the next step is you have more number of people, like people here. Not everyone can make noise, isn't it? So there's a guideline that you should keep quiet. But suppose this was some, you know, high level society or something like that, where there is some regulation existing that nobody else will opinion it. Okay, they will be debarred or something. Suppose it was a military rule or something, that then there is a state. Okay, so it starts with your inner morality, comes, gets modified by the guidelines, and then the state comes into play. And that's why, because we have so many people existing in this world, I'm not talking about India alone, because there are many unethical practices abroad also, which comes every other day in paper or listservs and things like that. You know, it's not like everybody is honest abroad and we are all very wrong, nothing like that. So that's why to control that, we have the regulations.
So this things, or this ethics seems to be very simple, and it's very much related to religion as well. So it could be incorporated in the school education as well?
Yes. You had moral science earlier, but some of the schools have taken it out saying that this is rubbish, we are losing time. Okay, so now it is going to be inculcated again. The Medical Council of India actually has now asked that ethics has to be taught at least for 2 months. And now there is a big furore saying that, oh, the course is going to get prolonged by 2 more months. Okay, they are not bothered that it is going to teach you values. They are more bothered about the 2 months to earn something.
Also called saffronization.
Ma'am, I have a question. I work for muscular dystrophy, mainly Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So I was in Hyderabad 2 months back, and there was an ICMR representative again. Mainly I wanted to voice out because I run a foundation where we have a holistic approach towards the student, molecular diagnostic, counseling, care and all that. So we have close to 3,000 children in our database with whom we are working. So I see lots of parents coming and asking about this stem cell therapy. So we tell them very categorically, no please, because there's nothing to back up the science and all that. And it's like 1.5 lakhs, 2 lakhs per injection and all that. But you know, poor parents, lots of them, they want to see something. and there are lots of groups which are encouraging, and this is happening lots in Bangalore. So I thought that's a platform where there were quite senior people sitting, and I voiced out saying this is happening and we should be doing something about this. And because parents sell their house, land, everything for this one or two injections, and they come back after that and say, ma'am, you told, but we thought something can happen, but no, we lost everything and they are in huge debt and all that. So I, you wouldn't believe, the whole team, they said, ma'am, I said, and one of the person said, can you get the addresses of doctors? I said, certainly, whoever are in Bangalore, I can get you the addresses to parents. But you won't believe, few of them told, actually, please sit down, don't do this, you won't go back home alive. So it was like, this is all going to happen, you just need to take it. Somewhere inside I couldn't accept, but that's what is happening around. So it's really sad.
Yeah, it's the money which pulls, you know. See, there's another stem cell person right behind ICMA, right behind All India Institute. Okay, ICMA team also had gone there to inspect, as well as the person also was called in to present before a group of experts about what they are doing. So you know, they have ways of you know, manipulating things. Like ICMA guidelines says that if it's a hopeless, they first say that you have to do animal experiments. Then second, just after that, the next statement is, in hopeless conditions, you can do it in humans. So they have got that, okay? And then you need to have an ethics committee. So ethics committee comprises of an uncle who is the legal expert and the mother who is another clinician expert in the group. So that is conflict of interest. So, and then it was said that ICMR should be reported or something, and she somehow got into her mind that it has to be reported to ICMR. So one page statement will come for such as, and you have to maintain confidentiality, that is flouted, the patient's name will be there. And she brought with her a booklet of 100 patients on whom she has done this. And when the team went there, there is absolutely no laboratory there, what method she used, nothing like that. And she tries all sorts of things, magnetic pull and this and that and all that. What has happened? All that, this has come in papers also. No action has been taken. Why? Because there were politicians there who were getting treated. And they publicized that, oh, it's a great thing. And when the ICMR team went there, there were patients. Whether they were taught to say that, we don't know. They told the team, why are you trying to stop this? This is the only hope that we have. And there was an ICMA scientist, again suffering from muscular dystrophy, great scientist, I mean very lovable person. He underwent that and was in the last stage. His wife called my boss, Dr. Vasanta, and she asked, can we take him there? She said, don't ask me. If you feel like you do it, don't ask me, because I do not advise that, you know. And then they went there. It's another matter that both these people ended up in ICU with myocardial infarction, because stem cells are supposed to create a thrombus to block anywhere it likes. So this has become evident only now, because stem cell research is in its infancy even now. Although therapeutic aspects have been allowed for adult type of cells, we are yet to know what could be further side effects to that. So instant relief, a prostate person sitting in a wheelchair is a great improvement. And she showed videos of her hand, you know, which was lifeless and suddenly it lifts. So that is evidence for the politicians to see, oh great, why should we stop that? But are the regulations being followed? Nobody is implementing that, because those that act pertaining to that has not come in.
Who should be doing it?
MCI can do it, but somebody has to actually give the thing in writing.
Thank you.